This video is just here to show the problem solving that I had to do on a couple of little things to make this a simple build.
Greetings, fellow DIYer, and welcome to my video.
So, I decided to build a steady rest for my lathe. It's a Harbor Freight 3-in-1 combo machine that is no longer a 3-in-1 combo machine. I've got lots of videos on the upgrades and things that I've done to this machine. And that's not what this video is about. This video is about the fact that because it's a Harbor Freight lathe and it's not Grizzly or Smithy or some of the other brands, I was not able to get a steady rest for it. And from time to time, I need a steady rest. So I decided to build one. Now, there are a lot of videos out there showing how people built steady rests for their machines. And so this video is not a complete build. This video is just here to show the problem solving that I had to do on a couple of little things to make this a simple build. Now, the first thing I had to do was be able to mount the steady rest to the ways of the lathe. And that's what this is right here. I have a mill. I'm not a machinist by any stretch of the imagination. I am a fabricator with some machining skills. So the thought of machining dovetails into a large block of steel or cast iron was very daunting to me. I'm sure I could have gotten it done, but I don't know how accurate it would have been, and it would have been a harrowing process. But as a fabricator, I came up with a much simpler way to do this. I took some steel and cut it at the 60 degrees that I needed for the ways, and then polished up a piece of steel that could be welded to now create the same dovetail effect in the bottom. There's a bolt in here that goes into this half. In the middle, I have a captured nut. I just drilled a hole through on both sides and I installed the nut on the bolt, got everything all lined up and basically tightened it down. And then I was able to rosette weld the nut from the top and from the bottom. And then once I get it on the ways, it's just as simple as tightening this knob down. I made this knob using a socket for a 9/16. I have an entire video on how you can do that. So that's the base. The main body of the steady rest is going to weld to this half, and this is what I will use to secure said steady rest. So here we have the install of the base on the lathe. Simply install this piece here, slide this piece into place, tighten it down, and just like any dovetail, it automatically pulls itself square and tight when you tighten it down. Very simple solution to a very potentially complicated machining process of cutting out the dovetails. Now, the next problem I ran into was my fingers. You can buy ready-made fingers, but I didn't want to do that because this is a DIY project. So I bought myself some half-inch keystock. I like working with half-inch keystock, keystock of any size for that matter, because it's very machinable. It's fairly strong, but it's also dimensionally accurate. It is whatever size it's supposed to be, it usually is very close within those tolerances. So it makes it a nice stock to start with. So this is my finger. Now, the first question is, how do you retract and extend the finger? So this is the extension and retraction mechanism for the steady rest. Square stock. It was solid. I drilled it out about 3 inches, so the hole goes into about here. And then I welded a nut to this end. Now, I could have threaded the entire length, but As the threads go further in, the more threads that are engaged, the less freely tends to spin. Plus, that's a whole lot of material to tap. To run a tap 3 inches down that was just way easier to weld the nut on. So this just unscrews and it would extend things. Now this is an all metal lock nut that I threaded onto the all thread, and it holds so well that I was able to chuck this up in the lathe and round it off so it would fit inside the square tubing that is on the outside of the steady rest. Then here we have an end cap that is welded onto the square tubing, and that gets sandwiched between this jam nut and this lock nut. And that means that this piece is going to stay locked in place no matter which way you spin it, and that is what is going to either extend or retract the finger. And then on this end, I just have a knob. The jam nut is actually jammed against the knob. I may end up using some Loctite if I find they loosen up, but at this point, I think the knob and the jam nut by themselves will be sufficient. If I had it to do all over again, one thing I would have changed is instead of doing right-hand thread, I would have done left-hand thread. And the reason for that is now when I tighten it down, it sucks the finger in. So tightening the knob loosens it on the steady rest. And in my mind, that's backwards. This is something I'm sure I will learn to live with. But if I had it to do all over again, I would have gone with the left-handed thread. Now the second problem to deal with is how do you have the finger come in contact with the work? Well, ideally, you want to use a roller bearing. To accomplish that, I drilled a hole in the end of my three fingers and I tapped it for a quarter inch bolt. Then I took a quarter inch tapered head screw, and that is what holds the roller bearings in place. Same thing on the other side. So I now have roller bearings that spin freely. They're perfectly centered because of the tapered head on the bolt, and it gives me a surface for it to ride on. So the next question is, how do we attach the fingers to the base that I showed you earlier? Well, I'm in the process of fabricating up a hexagon ring that will house my fingers and connect the fingers to the base. Now this is just one of six sides. Three of them are just a blank hex side, and three of them were machined to accept the fingers. So the finger will end up going like that, and that is going to hold it in place, and that way if your stock is right here and you're wanting to spin it, it will supply that support. Now you're probably thinking, why did he drill a round hole in that piece? Because now the finger has the ability to spin. Well, ultimately, this is a piece of 3/4 inch square tubing with an 1/8 inch wall. This is going to be welded on the outside of my hexagon. And now this is held firmly. It is not going to wiggle this way. Once this is locked down, it's not going to wiggle this other way. So I will have a nice solid mount that allows the finger to travel perpendicular to the piece. Then from there, I've got a 3/8 nut welded to the side to help lock everything in place. I have a 3/8 bolt that goes into here, and its purpose is to tighten that 3/8 bolt down into this nut and give you a nice tight connection to this, locking it in place. But what I don't want to have happen is for me to tighten down the bolt and have it mar this surface finish, because that's now going to rub inside this shaft and it's going to cause it to stick and it's going to cause issues over time. My solution was to make this right here, This is what I am referring to as a captured gib. It probably has some technical name that I have no clue on, but that's what I'm calling it, because it works just like a gib on a lathe, but it will be captured inside of here. So it's bent with arcs so that it's held in place. That way it's not flopping around and hard to position if for some reason I have to take the fingers out. And then when I go to install the finger back in, it's a little tight, which is a good thing. It is now held in place. And when I tighten a bolt down on this, this finger is going to no longer move. Now, when I do my final assembly, I will actually take and put a little bit of weld inside so that this captured gib cannot move into the next piece. And the same thing here. I'll put a little bead of weld in there. I'm not actually going to weld the internal piece down. I'm just going to create a stop so that it doesn't end up getting loose and making a corner to where I can no longer get to it. Because once this is all welded up solid, I will not have access to that piece. So that's what's going to hold it in place.
So the last problem I had to overcome was measuring the distance between the hexagon and the base so that I could fabricate a piece to go in between. Well, that doesn't seem like a problem. You simply take a tape measure or snap gauge and caliper or any other measuring device and you measure it. The problem is, if these fingers are not perfectly centered, that height is going to change. If this one is a little short and these two are a little longer to compensate, then welding it in that position is going to create an off-center situation. The obvious solution is to spend a bunch of time adjusting and measuring and adjusting and measuring and get it as close to centered as you possibly can, take your measurements, and call it good. But that's the hard way, the complicated way to do it. All you have to do is set up something round like I have here. I'm using a bullnose live center right here to position everything, get it all straight. Put the steady rest on there, get it adjusted close, probably within about an eighth inch. I have these all adjusted. Then measuring is a breeze. Let's put a level right there to make sure it's sitting level so that you, in theory, have the same measurement all the way across. Take your measurement from here to here. Then simply rotate this to the next area over. Now, in my case, it's going to hit the base. So, slide the base over, rotate around, slide the base back, put the level on there, adjust till we're level, take a measurement again, go to the third one. Now you're probably thinking at this point, what do three different measurements have to do with getting the correct measurement? Well, because all these measurements are in relation to each other, if you take those three measurements, add them together, and divide by three, you will get the perfect measurement. The measurement that you would have if everything was lined up dead center as it should be. So just a simple little trick to get everything centered and know how big the piece needs to be that goes from here to here.
I'm almost done with this project. Once I get it finished welded, it'll be put together and ready to go. I just wanted to make this short video to show you some of the little challenges that I was facing and the solutions that I came up with to solve them.
If you like what you've seen, please click like. If you'd like to see more, please subscribe. Thanks for watching.